Number one, what's your all-time favorite song?
All-time favorite song is I Can Only Imagine by MercyMe.
Brilliant. Teaser alert, we may have some interviews coming up this year. Those notes and that introduction, I have a feeling for many of our listeners, they mean something. Maybe they take you back to a memory of when you first heard the song I Can Only Imagine by the band MercyMe. It's Mark's favorite song of all time. Our guest today is special to both of us for a variety of reasons. In addition to being the lead singer of MercyMe, he's also released two solo albums. He has received a solo Grammy nomination. He's been called the best male vocalist by Christianity Today in 2005. He is from Greenville, Texas, and he and his wife Shannon have five children. He's the lead singer of arguably the biggest group in Christian music, that's MercyMe. They gained mainstream recognition with the crossover single I Can Only Imagine, which elevated their debut album Almost There to triple platinum certification. They've released 11 studio albums, six of which have been certified gold, two compilation albums, two video albums, and 28 singles. They've also had 13 consecutive top five singles on the Billboard Christian Songs charts, with seven of them reaching number one. MercyMe's also won 8 Dove Awards and has had many Grammy Award nominations. Our guest today is Bart Millard, lead singer of the band MercyMe.
Today. Hello, everybody. This is Josh Price, and you are listening to the Mark Price for Three podcast. Each episode, my dad will be talking NBA basketball, sharing some coaching and instruction, and of course, talking about his faith. Without further delay, here's my dad, Mark Price.
Welcome back to episode 12 of the Mark Price for Three podcast. This is a special one today. We have two recording artists and an NBL champion on this episode. Mark, why don't you introduce our guest and we'll go from there.
Well, excited, and I'm going to kind of get the fanboy deal out of the way, man, because Bart, you guys are my favorite group. I was so excited to get to meet you. It was funny because I'm not a big Twitter guy, but you know how we kind of met was I looked on my Twitter one day and it said that Bart Millard was following me. And so, of course, you know, that didn't, you never know who that is, you know, in the Twitter
world. Right.
And so I kind of texted you back one day because you guys were coming to Atlanta to do a concert. And I said, hey, this is Mark Price. I'd love to say hello. Big fan. And your response was great because you were like, is this the Mark Price that was drafted by the Mavericks in 86 and traded? And so that's kind of how it started out. But you're a big basketball fan, right, Bart?
I am. I'm a huge basketball fan. Yeah, I'm not, I can't play it. Although you could have put in there church league champions when I was an eighth grade. Yeah.
Well, the intramural champion was for me, Bart, not for you.
Oh, okay. Hey, yeah. That's all I got.
I'm just an intramural champion. But anyway,
that's awesome.
So have you always been a lifelong Mavericks fan?
Yeah, I grew up in Greenville outside of Dallas. And yeah, as long as they've been a team, you know, I've been in love with them from, you know, Jim Spanarkle to, you know, as far back as we can, like in Pat Williams, all those guys. But yeah, I became a diehard. Like basketball is the sport I never could play. I had the football body and I'd always try, and I've broken my ankles more times than I could count my whole life, thanks to basketball for the most part. And I don't know if I was envious or what, but I've always loved it and I'm obsessed with the Mavericks. Yes, I'm a huge Mavericks fan.
So I guess, you know, obviously most of my career was with the Cavaliers. And yeah. So I guess you're very familiar with the year the Mavs beat the Cavaliers.
And yeah. I'm very familiar. Yes. And, there's a few teams that were like I never disliked the Cavaliers, although, you know, like, Darty was frustrating. Like for some reason, like you and John Stockton, I was more bitter because I was like, you know, I don't know. I loved you guys so much. Larry Bird was my favorite basketball player, like before, you know, like growing up before I ever, you know, I grew up in an era where my kids play video games. And so I realized their favorite player, like they're not loyal to a team like they are players. And
right.
I mean, video games have a lot to do with that, but, and just the way people are traded. And so there are a lot of years where the Mavericks were not good, just being a new team and stuff. And where we lived, we would get more, Bulls and Braves because of TBN and because of WGN, right. And same with baseball. I fell in love with Bird just watching him play other teams. Cause we'd hardly ever get the Mavericks on our local channel, which was just three channels at the time. So I fell in love with him. And then like you guys, you and John Stockton were like, oh, just maddening to watch. it's like you never stop moving. And I became a huge fan, I guess. I mean, I was already a fan, but they're the dream team stuff. Like that kind of pushed everything over the top to where it's like, hey, it's okay to root for everybody right now. And, I was loyal to a fault, and I got to admit when you, I think it was 86. Yeah. When you were drafted and went straight to the Cavaliers, I would have been seventh grade. My brother was a senior in high school, and I was trying to impress my brother so much. This is for the internet or Google or whatever. And somehow I figured out through the newspaper or something, I found out what it was. And I was trying to be cool. I was like, oh yeah, I think isn't it the Georgia Tech guy from Bartlesville, Oklahoma? And my brother was like, what? And I was like, you know, I'm just keeping up or whatever. And I just remember that being the only fact where I looked like an idiot because I had no clue what I was talking about, but I just wanted to look so cool with my brother who was obsessed with basketball too. And so it's funny because if anyone else in 86 met me, I wouldn't probably have the tidbit of information of, oh, you were drafted the same day to the Cavaliers. You're from Bart. You're the one guy that I like obsessed on just to impress my brother.
That's hilarious. Well, you're probably one of the few that actually know I was born in Bartlesville, Oklahoma. So that's impressive.
I knew that because we started in Edmond, Oklahoma.
Okay.
I think there used to be a club called the Warehouse in Bartlesville, I think is where it was. And that we used to play at. And so, yeah, it's a small world. It's we spent. You know, Oklahoma's very important to us.
Yes. Yeah. Well, my family's still in Oklahoma, and, you know, I guess I'm kind of the black sheep. I went to Georgia Tech, married an Atlanta girl. So Georgia's kind of been home ever since. But that's awesome, man, because, you know, I was obviously at that time, Oklahoma didn't have a pro team. Thunder wasn't there at the time. And so the Mavericks were the closest thing to Oklahoma. So when I got drafted by the Mavericks, I was like elated. I was like, man, my parents will be able to come, you know, see me play. And then, you know, that lasted a whole 30 minutes. My agent called me and he goes, don't get too excited about Dallas. I think you're moving.
Man, I'm trying to think back then, because obviously if they had a high draft, I mean, 86, were the Mavs, were they good yet in 86? I know they had a run like in 89 when they took the Lakers to 7.
Yeah, they... You know, I think the reason that they moved me, they had a pretty decent backcourt at that time. Yeah. They had Derek Harper, Brad.
Rondo Blackman, Mark Aguirre.
Yep.
Roy Tarpley, Blackman, James Dawson.
Yep. You know your stuff, man. You know your stuff. So, you know, in all honesty, it worked out best for me going to a team that was rebuilding. And so I got an opportunity that I probably wouldn't have gotten in Dallas with all the guards that they already had there. So. You know, it really worked out well for me. And but Dallas, yeah, I always liked. That's why I always played well when I came to Dallas. I was a little ticked off too.
Right,
motivation.
Just to remind you what you're missing.
Currently, the Mavs sit at 23-18, the fourth seed in the West, and the Cavs at 26-15, and our fourth seed in the East. What do you guys think about where we're at this year?
Let me get my opinion out first, then we'll have to ask a pro. No, I haven't kept up with the Cavaliers much. Like, in fact, like, I don't think, I mean, I didn't even keep up with them when LeBron was there as much as, like, I was obsessed with all basketball back growing up. Like my Rain Man-ish moment was that I used to be able to name, like, all the starters of every team. I don't think I can do it anymore. But I just became obsessed with statistics like that. But I was, like, I think the Cavs are incredibly dangerous. And to me, maybe because I'm on the outside and feel very much under the radar with what else is going in the East. I think it was last year when I didn't realize how good they actually were or had the potential to be or whatever you want to call it last year. Because, you know, LeBron leaves and it's like they become like the redheaded stepchild is what it feels like. And And so I don't know much about them. I do know that the Mavs are they're, yeah, unless they get more help, that, you know, I mean, every game that Luka sets out, it's almost guaranteed to lose. And so it's like that's unsustainable. And they're fun to watch. Luka's I can't figure him out. He looks like the slowest player in the NBA, but he's so stinking good. Like everything, it feels like in slow motion, but it's so fun to watch. And I can't believe we went from Dirk to him, which is, you know, it's awesome to be a Mavericks fan, but I wish they would figure out. I like Christian Wood, but I wish they would figure out how to get one more, just another. I don't know if it's a big or what, but just somebody there to help him out. And I know they've been trying, and I don't know if it's Mark Cuban or if it's just the Dallas market. I have no clue, but, you know, I'm sure there's a lot to it, but I don't know. They're fun to watch. So at least they're not the worst team ever like they were in the 90s.
Yeah, it's the Mavericks are, they are a fun team to watch. And Luke is just, you know, he's just a once in a generation type of player. I mean, he's, like you said, he just doesn't fit the mold. Mm-hmm. But yet, you know, he's so good. You know, basketball ultimately comes down to passing, shooting, and, you know, yeah, and dribbling. And he's great at all of those things in his own time and his own pace. But I agree with you totally that he needs a Robin, you know, to go with
probably
his back, because, and you know, that would help them tremendously. But yeah.
A headline today, the Cavaliers are toying around with trying to get Hardaway Jr. from the
really?
I don't know if that's true or not, but we'll see.
Well, I think everybody right now that's in the mix, this is the time of year where everybody's like, okay, what's that one piece we can throw in here that can kind of, you know, help us at the next level. But, you know, from the Cavaliers standpoint, their team reminds me a lot of our team when we came into Cleveland with Doherty and Nance and Hot Rod and Ron Harper and those guys. And you know, you said the Cleveland market, nobody pays attention. Well, that's just kind of the curse of being in the Cleveland market.
Right.
Unfortunately, you know, I saw something yesterday where Austin Reeves from the Lakers had like more votes for the All-Star game than like Darius Garland. And I mean, it's just like,
yeah,
it's just like, I'm like, man, that's just, you know, Darius, man, good luck with that. I lived it for 9 years, man. It's just unfortunately the media coverage. But I will say that Donovan Mitchell's trying to bust through that media stuff, because it's hard to ignore a guy scoring 71 points in a game.
Yeah, I thought the Cavs were, I mean, heading in the right direction like last year, but maybe it's by the end of the season, because I wasn't paying attention. I think I was watching Sports Center and they started going through player by player, and I just didn't realize the team that they had just hadn't been paying attention. And then they get him, and it's like, man, I was blown away. I was already on like a high with the whole Luka, you know, the 60-20 and you know, or whatever it was, 20. And I was just blown away. And then that was like, man, let's see how many more things they can top this year.
It's incredible.
Would you guys agree? Luka is, I think, very under the radar, as you said, Bart. And Mark was very under the radar. Do you see comparisons in their games, Bart? And Mark, what do you think about Luka?
Man, I do from a standpoint of just anybody that is just is just freakish the way they pass. I think that's why, like, you know, like I'm, and maybe, I don't know if it's the way basketball is now. I think you're right. It kind of is, but like, I look at Daugherty and Mark and Malone and Stockton, and I'm like, and Luka, and I don't know if it's Christian Wood or whatever. But I'm just like, and I wish that they would find that person, but yeah, man, I mean, he's Luka's he's big and he looks soft, even though he's super strong. He's not a chiseled guy, so he's very deceiving. But, and the way he handles the ball and the way he passes reminds me of Mark and Stockton and Magic and just the crazy stuff he does. And I don't know, he you can't have that many triple doubles and be called selfish. I mean, he's pretty unselfish with the ball. And so, yeah, there's definitely similarities in that, because, you know, it's, I don't know, from what I watch, there's a lot of, there's definitely a lot of selfish players that, you know, that are, you know, I don't know. I mean, just sometimes it just feels like that passing is as important, if not more important, his assists are than his scoring. And I don't know if that's rare or not, haven't kept up, but I know it's special when you see it. And you know, and to see a point guard, or see, you know, like Mark Price, these guys that are true leaders that are like making everybody else look better because of their ability to pass. Yeah, I think there's similarities in that for sure, which, you know, and I think, I mean, I've never met Luka, don't know him at all, but I'm like, you know, to compare him with those names in the past is like a massive honor. I know he's you know, going to be one of the best ever, but that's a good lineage to keep up, man, the way he plays.
Yeah. Luka's he's a special player. You know, I think, you know, other than him being 8 inches taller than me, you know, he just has a feel. And you mentioned passing. I think that that's an art in a lot of ways. And, you know, there's guys that pass, but there's the really good passers. Not only do they make the pass and sometimes make a difficult pass, but it's always on time. It's always in the right spot. Yeah. And it always helps the guy who catches it score the ball. And people don't really talk about that a lot when it comes to it, because, I mean, you know, they're big guys. Oh, yeah, I passed it to you. Well, yeah, it was down at my ankles. You know, what am I supposed to do with that? You know, but, you know, you take the Nikola Jokic for Denver as well. You know, he's another guy that pops up from the center, from the center position. I mean, he literally, you know, has unbelievable court vision. I mean, his back's to the basket, and yet he's whipping passes all over the place. And they're on time and they're in the right spot. And that's what makes a great passer. And Luka has that ability. And I would just say, you know, comparing myself with Luka, I mean, the biggest difference to me was obviously the size, but his ability with his size, you know, if he needs to get a shot off, he can get a shot off. You know, I wasn't blessed, unfortunately, with that ability to rise up over somebody and shoot the ball. I had to be much more creative, and I had to use my teammates, whether it be ball screens or pin down screens or things like that, find ways to get open, create space where Luka, he doesn't have to do that near as much as I did to be able to get a shot off.
It's funny, very funny. You met Mark like a week before you met me backstage in Columbus and Atlanta for Mark. So that was very weird. But I think I told you then that I'm a Cleveland fan. And so I was thrilled the day that they flipped the trade with the
Mavs. Oh, nice. I'm a Cleveland fan. Okay.
I'm sorry. I'm a Cleveland fan. So but just to transition to the next phase, we always talk about coaching, but I think Mark has some questions about you. We opened with the fact that Mark's favorite song is I Can Only Imagine. And I think Mark maybe is not the only one. I think there's probably a few out there that have I Can Only Imagine as their favorite song. Mark, do you want to ask some questions about the movie? Because I know you had some thoughts about that.
Yeah, I just, you know, was curious because, you know, you see people do movies about people's life story. And first of all, to have somebody want to do that, I mean, that's just got to be incredible. But my first question about that would just be, were you pleased how it turned out? Did it feel like it was on track? You know what I'm saying? You always wonder when that happens, you know, how much input did you have? How much, you know, or did they just kind of make up stuff? You know how things go, but I was just curious of your thoughts. If you liked the movie, because sometimes when people make movies about them, they don't like them. And then, you know, we'll go from there.
I wasn't sure how to feel because I never experienced it. And I was very involved from day one. It took about 8 years from when somebody had the idea to it actually happening. And some of this lady in a production company, she had this idea. She wanted to make a movie about, she was asking around the most popular song at the time. And she didn't ask me, she asked other people. And apparently when she finally got to us, she goes, everybody at the time saying Shout to the Lord or I Can Only Imagine. And I'm assuming Shout to the Lord didn't have a story because I was second and she never told me, but she decided she wanted to go with this movie. And I didn't believe it. I was like, okay, whatever, you know, good luck with that. It's never going to happen. And all I remember is that when they do this, they have to buy your life rights is what they call it. And what it'd be like, if there's a part of your story, Mark, that they want to tell, they'll pay you. It's not much, like $3,000 or $4,000 a year to say, no one else has the right to tell the story. Give us a year to make some progress. And when a year's up, you can either say no, or we'll give you another $3,000 or $4,000 and we'll keep working. Well, so I'd get like a check for $3,000 or $4,000 for like 5, 6, 7 years. And it's not much, but I never thought the movie's going to happen. I was like, if you just want to hand over, I'll take my kids to Disney or something. Thanks for doing this. And so it got, it was so long that I thought, man, they're crazy. They keep paying me for this. I mean, this could go on forever, you know, because sometimes they say that some of these movie companies will do that for 25 years to hang on to a book or something that may never happen, but they don't want anybody else to do it. That's what I'd heard. So I was like, all right. So that was the end of it for me. And then about 6 years in, she sold her company. So I thought it was over, and the Irwin brothers happened to buy the rights to the movie. And then, so in a way it's been 6 or 7 years, but it started over. And so took about 2 years to write the script and film and get it all, you know, so I could release it. And it went from slow as molasses to like kind of a whirlwind, like, you know, and so from casting to, they interviewed me for hours and hours on video, just trying to get the story. And so we're so immersed in it that, I remember telling my wife, we were getting to the point where it's almost done. And I was like, she goes, what do you think? I was like, I honestly have no idea, because I have to believe that whoever made those awful movies you've ever seen, didn't they have to believe it was going to be good at some point? It's like, no one just sitting here making terrible movies. They had, and so I thought, I have such vertigo in this thing. It may be terrible. Like, I think it's okay, but I have no idea, because, you know, somebody had to believe in Ishtar at some point or something like that. And so I didn't know what to think until it was, you know, I remember when I read the first draft of the script, it was very emotional. When I went to watch them film, it was all filmed in the state of Oklahoma. It was very emotional to see all these scenes, even though it's like, you know, Dennis Quaid and it's, you know, it's pretend. I never realized how emotional it would be to, you know, to watch the doctor tell Dennis Quaid he has cancer as my dad. Like, it was very strange and in some ways therapeutic. And then finally watching it, the first edit was emotional. But then when I finally saw it with an audience and saw how they responded, you know, you talk about people that talk about how they're upset about a movie, it's told about them. I just want to believe that doesn't happen until the crowd decides if they like it or not, because it's so long to make an album. There's so many times you could say, I'm out, I don't want to do it, but they keep hanging on there. Then they'll go, I'm so embarrassed. I think it's like they're covering their tails when the crowd doesn't or doesn't. I don't know. I could be wrong, but I can't imagine somebody being shocked that it's bad when it takes 2 to 3 years to make. Anyway, so watching with an audience and just seeing the emotion was incredibly emotional. And it's funny, I was so wrapped up in telling the story, and people ask how accurate it is. And I always say, it's like trying to cram 25 years of my life into 2 hours. Right. There are things that are incredibly inaccurate. You know, like I grew up in a little ranch home in the middle of town, not on a farm, but it looked better on the screen. And they would explain that stuff to me. And I didn't, you know, you pick the things that are a big deal to you that you want to hang on to. And for me, I didn't care about that stuff. I cared about, like, I wanted the abuse to be fairly accurate and not watered down so that the redemption story would have value and things like that. And so the things that were important to me, they handled with kid gloves and were very accurate. You know, some of the small details, like, you know, my high school was red and white, not green, stuff like that, that I, you know, and then the time frame is always kind of compressed to where this stuff happened over about a 7-year period, where in the movie it feels like it happened in a week. But, yeah. But other than that, like, once I realized that's kind of how movies are made, it was able, cause at first I was like, that's not right. That's not right. This is not right. You know, or whatever. And, once I got over that and realized, okay, the things that are important to me are in place, then I was able to kind of like relax and enjoy it. And so looking back, I'm incredibly pleased, but it took me a little bit to get there. Not that I was bitter, just I was kind of numb to it. Like, I'm not sure how I feel, you know, and, right. And then you hear enough stories. The thing that I think the part, not all of it's embarrassing or whatever, is that I got so wrapped up in the making of the movie, I totally forgot or lost sight of the ministry aspect of it, to be honest with you. Like, I remember the first time we watched with an audience, you know, I'm sitting there thinking, was this joke funny? Was the timing good? That kind of stuff. And then I watched this guy, we're leaving, and we're standing out shaking hands up, and this lady says, this one man won't leave the theater. And so they go back in, and we're kind of looking at the door, like, what's going on? And I'm not sure who it was, but he was in tears, and he was like, I can't leave until I get my father on the phone. And he wanted to, like, deal with this relationship with his dad that had been, you know, not in a good place for a long time. And he goes, just give me a second, give me a second. And just kept trying to call him and was crying. And that was the first time I was like, oh no, like, how does it slip your mind when you're in ministry of the impact this could have on, you know, fathers and sons and relationships. And it was weird. I was a little embarrassed by it, but then it was like, all of a sudden it felt brand new because these movies, it's kind of like writing a song. You know, I listen to a song 1,000 times before you ever hear it. And the last thing it is when it releases to me is brand new. It's like, okay, I'm ready to move on to something else. And the movie's even worse, as much time as they spent on that for years.
Right.
And so that kind of gave it new life for me, like on the day that it opened, of like, and it was like an avalanche of response, and it's not like anything I've ever seen.
Well, it's just, it was amazing, you know, for me personally. And I just want to thank you guys for doing that and be willing to do that, because I can't even imagine how many lives you touch for the kingdom. Just your transparency of your life. I mean, Sherry, I mean, those things with, you know, when that movie came out, what year did that movie come out?
18, I believe. Yeah.
Yeah. 18. But, you know, I lost my father. I had a good relationship with my father, but I lost him, you know, early. He died when he was 62. And so there was just, I think, like me, and no matter what people were dealing with, whether it be abuse or just loss of your father or a loved one, that song and that movie just, you know, it meant a lot to me, because I think for so many people, it's like we think of heaven, right, all the time, and you talk about heaven, but you guys gave us a little bit of a glimpse through that song of, man, what it is to look forward to, you know what I mean? And
yeah,
it was just so awesome. But just wanted to tell you how much that song means to me, and that's why it's my favorite, and not because it's everybody else's favorite, but it's just, you know, it was awesome the first time I heard it, and that movie was great. And as far as the movie goes, I guess my only other question is, did you get to meet Dennis Quaid?
Yeah, we've become really good friends, and during the pandemic, he moved to Nashville, and so I see him every once in a while. He's a great guy. I think all actors are random, but, you know, it's like, I mean, you know, he's an interesting character. Like, we're good friends, but it's like, the movie, it was funny, 'cause during that thing, he was, just want to talk about, I think he grew up in like a Baptist church in Houston, and, as a kid, and his mom, who just passed away not long ago, was like his world to him. And he goes, man, I've done so many dang movies, and my mom was more excited about this song and this movie than anything. Like, she was like, finally kind of stuff. And so it was kind of a weird time. And he was, man, he, you know, he's a musician, and he kept writing songs during the movie that, you know, and they were all really just songs that his mom always hoped he'd write. So that was kind of a cool journey. Nothing anybody'd ever really hear or whatever, but he kept writing these spiritual songs, and there's kind of this sweet, you know, innocence too. I think he'd be the first to admit that, you know, he's not the greatest songwriter, but it doesn't matter when it's that sincere. It was like, man, how do you not enjoy this? And so, you know, it was an interesting time. I don't know much about him. I've just, you know, other than what the news may say. And right. I know at that time, like, he always kept telling me that the movie was perfect timing for his life. Yeah, he's become a good friend, which is weird. I don't know. Like I said, I've never done it before. Don't know how it works. And I figured that I would meet him and that'd be the end of it. But yeah, we stayed in touch. You know what's funny about, you're talking about you and your dad. And when I realized, you know, I always thought, okay, this movie will have something to, you know, deal with people that don't have a good relationship with their dad, you know, and it'll probably be targeted towards that. And I used to go to this men's group here, Bible study. And it was like this friend of ours put this group together of, his whole idea was, there's some people, it'd be like, if you lived here, some people going to a regular small group would be hard for them. Like, you know, and then not become a meet and greet. Right. And so it was like, in this group was like me and like Barry Zito and R.A. Dickey and For King and Country and all these different people of different walks of life, Dave Ramsey and all these people. And we were one night, the guy that heads it up was asking, like, let's talk about your relationship with your dad. I don't know if the movie was even finished. We were still making the movie. And I was like, oh, I've got this one knocked out of the park. Like, I'm sitting there going, I'm going to have the worst story. I'm going to win, whatever that means. And so everybody was telling their stories. And so I went through mine. I'll never forget. I think it might have been Barry Zito. I can't remember who it was. But he was talking about it. He goes, man, he goes, my dad was perfect. Like, he's my best friend. Like he was there for everything. And he kept saying it. And I'm like, oh, okay, you win. You know, like, but I'm like, you know, there's nothing here. But it's funny because then he said, and I ended up going to therapy because I could never get out of his shadow or be what I, you know, I could, I wanted him to be so proud of me because he's so great. Cause I'm sitting there going, I'm going to therapy because of the abuse. And I just want my dad to even know that I exist. And then I had this moment where I was like, what the heck, good or bad? We're all going to therapy, trying to figure out who we are in comparison to our dad, whether they're the most amazing human at all. And I just never forget, like when the movie came out, hearing a lot of stories of like both ends of the spectrum. It wasn't like my dad was never there. It was, my dad was always there. And I adore him to this day. And I feel like I can never be half the man that he is, to where some people would struggle with that. And I was like, man, it's just amazing how God would use the movie, which I thought was in a specific story, but that it kind of had such a much bigger reach than I ever thought possible, even with that song and over the years. And so, but yeah, when you mentioned that, I thought that's the one story I was like, oh, okay. You know, we're a lot more similar than I thought, because I thought I'm an abused kid or whatever, and this guy had the perfect relationship, but all of a sudden we're still wrestling with our identity outside of our father.
Well, I think that just goes to, you know, from a spiritual perspective, how important fathers play, the role that they play in the lives of their children. And for men to obviously, one, love the Lord, to be that example to their children, but to, you know, just to be that rock, that, you know, that leader that God created us to be. And I think, you know, we see a culture right now in so many ways where guys are abdicating that responsibility, or they're running from it, or fathers are being put down in the, you know, in the media in so many ways. And, you know, we're always the dumb guy, you know, on the sitcoms and this and that. And yet, you know, what you've seen, you know, through all this is, you know, kind of what an important piece the father is in all their kids' lives. And it's a humbling, but, you know, responsibility that we as, you know, as fathers and believers, you know, when we're trying to do it the right way, I mean, it just benefits our kids in so many ways.
Yeah.
And, good times and bad times. But man, fathers just gotta show up, man. You got to keep showing up, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think it is like it's kind of the front line, if you will. Like I think, yeah, you're right. It's dumbed down so much, and it's almost like it's I don't know. It's like there's this impression that it's not a huge deal, and I think that's part of the way the enemy's winning is that how he kind of desensitized to, you know, the role that a father plays, and it just keeps just knocking them down. I mean. I spent half my life believing the lies of the enemy that I wasn't equipped, that my dad wasn't great at it, so I'm not going to be great at it. And it was, I think, my doctor that delivered me, that's still alive. He told me one day out of the blue, he was like, hey, man, when we had our first kid, actually, he was like, hey, if you're just worried about whether you're a good parent or not, you're probably a pretty good parent. And he's like, it's just the fact that you hang on to it. I promise there's some that just don't care at all. And he's like, you're not going to get it right. That's okay. He goes, but the fact that you're willing to try again and that you do lose sleep over, am I doing it right? That's the sign of a good parent. So just give yourself a break. And some of the best advice I ever had, because I'm bad. I'm sure, man, if you're on a pro level, anything, there's a perfectionist in you. And if you can't do it at a certain level, why do it at all? And sadly, as a parent, I would feel like that. And you know, my doctor's one of the most gracious people ever, is like, man, give yourself a break, dude. Just show up, just keep showing up. And, you know, you're going to get it wrong. You're going to say stupid things and never going to forget it. And they're going to get therapy because of it one day. Keep showing up.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right. Well, if it's all right with you, Bart, let's transition over more into the music side of things for a little while. And just a quick hitter for me, my three favorite songs of MercyMe are obviously one, you know, I Can Only Imagine, but Word of God Speak. Okay. I'm old school, but then Even If.
Okay, yeah, know. Yeah.
And I love that. I mean, one of my favorite stories in scripture is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and about to get thrown into the fire, and you know, they know that their God can save them. They know that he can, and they believe that with all their heart, but they're like, even if he doesn't, you know, we're still going to praise him. And that song when it came out, just really, because that's one of my favorite stories in scripture. And I just love that song. Or I know you got a million and they're probably all your babies. if you had to pick like three, you know, what would be your top three of your own songs
that would be tough. Like for me, there's a song called Finally Home that's important to me. And that was just out of, it was written on the 10th anniversary of I Can Only Imagine. We were in the studio and our label reminded us that they were thinking we wanted to re-record a new version or whatever. We're like, nah, we got the old one. And, but we're in the studio and started talking and I was like, man, I can't believe it's been 10 years since I wrote that song, which was 10 years after, or about, yeah, like 8 or 9 years after my dad died. And so we were closing on 20 years of my dad being gone. And I was like, man, when my dad died, I was 19. I was nothing. I was trying to stay in college, which didn't work out. And I wanted to sing, but my dad wanted me to get a regular job because he knew, I mean, there was no American Idol or anything. It wasn't, and there was no YouTube. So saying you want to be a singer was like, okay, he's a janitor for the rest of his life or whatever. And so looking back, I was telling the guys like, man, I wish my dad could see me now, you know, with everything that's gone on. And I know people are like, he's looking down from heaven. And I don't know if that's true or not. There's no scripture that says that's actually true. Maybe he has more important things to do than stare at me all the time. I don't know. But I do know that there'll be a time when I get to kind of refresh his memory if he doesn't know of all the things that have happened. And it just, that moment became really emotional. And so Finally Home came out of those conversations of like, it was kind of like closure to Imagine, if you will, that song. And and so that was always been special to me. Even If has always been, and it's funny because favorite songs to me aren't like they were this successful or whatever. It's just, it's whatever I was going through. And you know, I'm not one to sit around and listen to our songs very much, but when you're writing them, you have to hear them a lot. And so that's the time when they minister to me, is trying to solve the puzzle and how it gets said. And whenever the melody and the lyric and everything fits just right, it's like, it's got to be like a drug. It's exhilarating. And, you know, I remember when we first got approached about the movie, I started going to counseling for grief counseling over my wife's brother was 19, was killed in a car wreck in 2004. And it was a really weird time. And I just went into this really deep depression. And, you know, I'm supposed to be a Christian, never get counseling. You know, Jesus is my counselor or whatever. And I decided to go and really process a bunch of stuff. And it's the first time in my life that I ever connected my childhood with the way I handle things, stuff like that. And it just so happened that the movie was being made at the same time. I didn't get it because of the movie, but without that counseling and being able to unpack my childhood, that movie could have wrecked me, you know, or, you know, to not be prepared to see that stuff on the screen for the first time would have been devastating. And so God was definitely in that. And in that, I wrote a song called Dear Younger Me, that was incredibly therapeutic to me of just like, and it was out of a counselor saying, if you could just write the letter to this, you know, 11-year-old kid, what would you tell him? And dude, I chewed on that question for a year. Like, it's like nervous about like it's going to happen. And I only have 5 minutes, you know, whatever. It's like, I'm so stressed. And I'll just never forget. There's a line in the bridge that just says like, you know, if I could change everything, you know, if there's one thing I wish you'd know or whatever, it would be dear younger me, it's not your fault. You were never meant to carry this beyond the cross. And I remember writing that and having to sing it over and over because I couldn't stop crying every time I do the vocal. So that's definitely one that is, you know, it's my favorite because it's like, they're all my songs are like children. And that was a very special kid to me, just the process of, you know, like creating that one. And then Even If was the same kind of thing. My oldest son, I've got 5 kids. My oldest just got married. He's 21. And he was diagnosed with juvenile diabetes when he's 2. And so we, you know, dealt with that his whole life. And man, when Even If came about, I can't remember what exactly, I just had one of those days to where, you know, if you've dealt with any kind of chronic illness, just the fact that it never lets up, you just have moments to where you can't do it anymore. And a friend of mine, an artist named Tim Timmons, one of my dear friends, I was at his house and I was supposed to write a song with him. And I just started venting on, you know, it's just not, I mean, give me something that goes away. Give me something that heals. Give me, you know, and just and just couldn't take anymore. And, you know, I didn't want to write. And so I was leaving and I told him, I said, man, I just want to be like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When it all hits the fan, I want to have enough courage one day to say, even if God doesn't show up, I can still do this. I wasn't saying that I was that guy. My desire was, I wish one day I could be that guy. Make that clear. Half of these songs sound like I'm super Christian, and all of them are like, I am so inadequate. And this is all the things I wish I could be. And Tim sent me this voice memo, and he wrote the chorus to Even If 5 years before, because Tim has been dealing with a cancer that he's living with it for 12 years. And he wrote just a couple lines of the chorus. And he goes, here's something that I was in your same boat and could never figure it out 5 years ago. And I wrote the rest of it like in 5 minutes, like it unlocked something. And it was between that story, Shadrach, Meshach, and then also just the old hymn of like, man, I wish I could honestly say that something is truly well with my soul, that I could be okay with that and not let it consume me. And, you know, and so all of that was, you know, it's not having it together. It's quite the opposite. It's like, God, this is all going south very quickly, but somehow, you know, somebody wrote me, is like, I can't believe you're so brave to still worship through all this. It's like, no, I'm not brave. I have to worship through it, or it'll be the death of me. Like, it's like, I'm not worshiping because I got it together. I'm worshiping hanging by a thread. Like, I have to keep worshiping the same way that we get in the word when things are going poorly. Like, I have to do it. I have to. But yeah, so those three, and for a long time, have been my, when people ask, what are your favorites? Those are the three that come to mind. I love Imagine, don't get me wrong. And of course, I'm grateful for it, but those are like, yeah. And that was therapeutic, you know, almost 30 years ago. Or no, I guess it'd been 20 years or 22 years ago now. But these are more recent and yeah, just mean a lot to me.
Well, that's they're personal to you more than anybody else. And so yeah, these songs would mean something special to you that none of us could ever understand. But, you know, it's gotta be unbelievable, just humbling, you know, the times I know that God has really used me, you know, because of what I do. I know it's just gotta be humbling to, you know, put something out there and see how God's using that in other people's lives. And that's just, that's why so many people love Mercy Me and they love you, Bart, is because you're real and you're humble and you care and you're about the right things. But I guess just a couple quick hitters music wise for me would be, okay, what's the one song that as soon as you started writing it, you said you knew it was going to be a hit? And then the one song that you were writing that you thought was going to be a hit.
Yeah, totally.
You know, and how does that process work? You know, do you just kind of feel like this one's going to be the one, or maybe there's one you wrote one time that you thought, oh, this is going to be terrible, and everybody loved it, you know?
Yeah, there's definitely different approaches to writing, like the Dear Younger Me's and Bring the Rain and Even If. Those are like, I feel like they were written with no one else in mind. Like, if it never made the album, I wouldn't really care because it kind of served its purpose for me personally. Then there are others that literally we are trying, you know, to write a banger, if you will, like, right, this is what radio wants. The one that I knew would be a hit was probably Flawless. Like, that sounds so arrogant, but I'm just saying, when we wrote it, we were so excited in the studio that we called the label immediately. And it was one of the first ones we wrote for that album. We were like, we have the radio single, so now we're just going to do the rest of the album. Like, it was almost like we got that out of the way, because they'll pressure you. Like, what's the single? What's the single? What's it going to be? And we wrote that out of the gate, and we're like, yep, that's the one. Let's push it aside and let's make whatever album we want now, because we made the label happy with the radio single.
Right.
And, the one that I thought was going to be one, which no one would hear about, we had an album called Coming Up to Breathe that had songs like Hold Fast and So Long Self and Bring the Rain. And this would have, I don't remember what year it was. This is probably 2005. And the first song we wrote on that was a song called Safe and Sound. And I knew, I was like, we did it again. This song is going to be huge. Like, for some reason, I was so like, this is easy. And I sent it to the label. They were like, yeah, it's great. It's great. And then two more years of making the album, I feel like. It's almost like manna from heaven. Like if you collect it and you keep it to yourself, it spoils. And that song went from one that I thought was going to be the single, the greatest. And then 2 years later, it was the oldest and we were tired of hearing it before the album ever came out. It just kept moving to the back of the line, to where at the last minute, we're like, all right, fine, let's put it on the album, this dumb song. It felt like it just, you sit on it that long. That's the hard part about making an album. And people always ask like how the industry's changed and, you know, that there's, you know, people don't make much money off streaming and Spotify and stuff. And there's some truth to that, but it's just, it's changing. Like you can definitely make a living at it. But I always say the best part about it is music's getting from the artist to the fan faster than ever. Cause the worst thing, man, it's when you write a hit and then it's like most of the time, if you write it, there's at least 6 months to a year before anyone will ever hear it because you've got to finish the rest of the record. It's just, that's the typical timing. And it's hard to be excited about something that, you know, especially when you write at that moment, whatever emotion it stirs up, that's the thing. It's like, it's, that's what makes you want to put on the album because it stirred something inside of you. And to hang on and keep telling yourself, this is going to stir something in somebody else, hopefully, because I'm so done with it. Because it's like, you know, 6 months to a year, it's like, we have a song right now that our next single, I think, is a song called To Not Worship You. And it was supposed to be on our last album, Inhale, Exhale. And so it got pulled off that. I can't remember why. I think because we thought it could be a radio single. We had our singles picked. So he said, you know, this is weird. And we're in the pandemic. We made the album. Let's set it aside and maybe it could be a single for the next album. And I hope it'll work out fine. But for us, it was a mistake because now we're looking at a solid 3 years since the song's been written. And whenever we listen to the album, I skip over it every day because I'm like, you know, if I'm listening, I'm like, nah, that song's so stinking old. And then we'll have friends call and go, man, this is the song. And we're like, no, it can't be. It can't be. It's so old. There's new, you know, I'm fond of these newer songs. And the label had to set us down and go, you have to stop looking at the song as old. No one else has heard it. It's the one. And so it's funny because we're trying to stir up this emotion. Like we're super excited about a song that is literally 3 years old. Like was finished and mixed 3 years ago. But in your head, you're like, if it wasn't good enough to be a single immediately, what are we doing? But it was part of the plan was let's wait. And so anyway, that's a weird feeling to, you know, we got a brand new song for you guys. It's a 2-year-old with a mustache and beard and 7'3", but you're going to love it. It's brand new. That's what it feels like.
So I have a question for both of you guys. You're both dads. And we talked about this a minute ago. Bart talked about this. Bart, your son is now taking the baton a little bit. And I know you guys performed on one of your albums. Mark, your sons and your children have had success in athletics. What's it like being the parent and seeing your kids have success in the fields that you played in and that you are passionate about?
Man, I don't know about you. I didn't try to talk my kids out of it, but I wasn't I didn't want to be the coach whose son's the quarterback kind of guy growing up. But also like I didn't know that all my kids can sing. We moved to Nashville and he was 12 and that was a hard time for him from Dallas. That was a hard time for a 12-year-old and he went through a little bit of depression and we got him a guitar and the guitar became his best friend with the lessons and all stuff. And I knew he played, but I'd literally never heard him sing. Like he was almost embarrassed to let me hear it. There'd be times I'd slide my phone under his door trying to hear him and he'd kick it out. And when he was 15, I remember we let him have an Instagram account. And one night I'm laying in bed and my wife's looking at her phone and I hear this guy sing. And I was like, hey, that's really good. Like, that's really good. And my wife's crying. And I'm like, well, he's not that good. What's going on? Like, what's happening here? And she's like, this is your son. And it was so like, it was just so good. Like, honestly, like without me knowing it was him, I was on board. And up until that point, I always thought, man, if they can sing, like, am I gonna, you know, I didn't want to assume that they're, you know, like you have the mom goggles on or what they call it, where it's like, he's the greatest ever and he's not. And so I was real careful and I didn't want to like talk him out of anything. But also I knew, you know, it is harder. The music industry is so hard, especially now versus when we were doing it just to make a living. And so I just kind of waited and kept watching. And I saw this kid that was incredibly passionate and just, you know, kind of, I would say saying all the right things. Like, I'll just live on love. I don't care. I just want to make music. Even if I have to work at Home Depot or whatever. And I was like, Sounds like I did. Like the best advice I was given is if you can walk away from ministry and this stuff, go ahead and do it, because we don't need people that are putting about 50% in this thing and not everything they have. I never forgot that. It actually, I kind of hesitated going into ministry and doing this because of that advice, but I would still tell my kids that. And I could see it in Sam. He's like, you know, he's going to do it regardless. And that's kind of what I was wanting to see. And he is incredibly talented. Like, and so when that point came, and then I kind of became, I will do everything I can to help you, you know, if you want it. But I just want to make sure it was like, you know, I didn't want to end up being entitled where he's like, I want to do this now. But it's like, he was going to do this with or without me. And that's when I was like, I'll do everything I can to help you in this. And it's been an amazing relationship. There's a lot of times where he thinks I'm an idiot and he doesn't think I know what I'm talking about. When it comes to music and stuff, he does have a respect that, like, he'll listen to me and take my advice. I may not know it until he tells my wife later, this is what Dad said. I'm like, oh, okay, he was listening. But yeah, I'm his biggest fan. You know, I'm still right now on a spiritual side. I'm like, I just praying that he just keeps understanding more of who he is in Christ, because he has the goods. But you know, he's a kid, and you know, I didn't know what I was talking about at 20 or 21, and you know, and now he's married, and it's like, I just, you know, there has to be this aha, this click moment that happens between him and God. And he's, you know, I think he's struggling with being angry as a diabetic his whole life and has a lot of questions. And it's just, you know, and just giving him room to process that. And he's got the talent. And when that clicks, it's like he could be an unstoppable force. Like, you know, we'll see. But it's amazing to watch. And, you know, and that's, you know, I do everything I can to help him. But then also I try to stay out of the way, because what's sad with him, and I wonder about this, because if you're, you know, if you have a child who has a parent that is remotely successful, and then they go in that field or, you know, something similar. Of all the success I've had, and then my son has, especially my oldest, has been around his entire life. He was born the week that Imagine went number one. All he remembers is the moments when I get home and I'm frustrated because I've created such a machine that, and you know, that if I want to sit on a porch and smoke a cigar with one of my friends from church, I have to look over my shoulder, or, you know, make sure no one's watching, or have to say the right things all the time. And what, of all the things that we've had, and those are the things he remembers, is like, I don't want to be backed in a corner. Like I don't have to be this all the time. And he's not talking about a Christian. He's talking about that whole, the switch is always on. Somebody's always watching. And those are far and few between versus the amount of fun and great things that have happened. But it's funny, those are the things that resonate with him, that he's like, I would rather, you know, like, to the point to where, like, Need to Breathe and Colony House, these bands that are kind of believers, kind of have a foot in both markets, he'd rather do that. And because he's like, don't call me a worship leader unless I realize what it means to truly lead worship, which I do appreciate him even saying that. But he's so scared of, like, just, he doesn't want to be, he loves music so much right now that he doesn't want to be bitter towards it one day. And I've told him that too. One day it's going to become your job, so you enjoy it as long as you can, if you do this right. And so anyway, I just told my wife the other day, it's curious what he remembers more than anything are those handful of times where I came home and was hurt somehow. And I don't know, it's just interesting what they choose to store in their memories.
No doubt. I think anytime somebody's successful in whatever field that it is, I know my boys both played basketball and both played, you know, were both very good players, played at the college level. And, but yet it, you know, it got to be comical to me, probably not comical to them in a lot of ways, but like the first question anybody ever, you know, can you shoot as good as your dad? You know? And I'm like, I mean, that's just, you know, why does somebody have to go there? You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's just and my youngest son, he's, you know, if you ever met him, my older son's a lot more serious. So he would kind of take that to, you know, it would bother him a little bit.
Right.
Whereas my younger son, he'll just kind of come right back and be like, well, no, but you can't either. And neither can anybody else, yeah, you know, kind of deal. And, you know, just that way. But Yeah, but it's just, you know, it's something that they can't, unfortunately, there's nothing we can do about it. That's something that God brought in our lives. They can't ever totally get away from being our sons and or daughters or whatever. And what comes with that and expectations, if you play in the same field or if you sing in the same field or whatever, those things are going to come. And so you just try to help them navigate it the best they can and let them know, hey, you know, I love you, you know, you got your own path.
Yeah.
And, you know, follow God and do your own path and know that I love you. And I mean, our best times, you know, we just getting out in the driveway and shooting hoops, you know, together and doing those kinds of things when nobody's watching, it's just us and just spending time. We go back to that, you know, relationship we talked about earlier, man. It's just being there, you know, just showing up. I mean, my kids didn't care about Mark Price, the basketball, you know, star. I'm dad, you know, and they just want to hang out with dad. And let's do
it. My question is, in the driveway, can they shoot as good as their dad?
most days, no.
Okay.
Most days, no. But I can't move like they can, and they're both like 4 or 5 inches taller than me. So the one-on-one stuff went away a long time ago.
See, the good news, what I love about that was, I told my wife one day, I was like, I'm glad I'm like Carl Lewis or somebody to where one day they're going to outrun me, you know, but if you have a shot or it's like everyone's saying, you go, okay, big boy.
Yeah.
I can still sing, but I'm not doing anything physical like that, but it's like, at least you have a shot. It's like, put that on the table if you need to.
At the end of the day, if it's not going well, I can always say, all right, let's get to the free throw line, guys. Get the free throw line.
That's amazing.
Well, my kids are trying to be intramural champions. So
there you go.
I don't fit in this conversation at all. But probably one of the top questions we get for Mark is, what was it like being on the road as an NBA player? The challenges, the things that come up, the temptations, all those things. Mark's answered that question a few times. Both of you can weigh in here. But what's it like being on the road, being in the spotlight, being on tour all the time, away from our families? What is that like, and how do you fight those temptations? That's the number one question we get.
Well, I know for me, like I always say, I don't know how solo artists do it, because like the four guys and other four guys in the band are like my best friends, and we've been together for, you know, 28 years. And so I couldn't imagine doing any of this without them. And so, you know, my wife says, you have the greatest job in the world because you get to work with your best friends. And she's not wrong. Like, and we're still to this day incredibly close. And so that's been the, people are like, how do you keep it together? I'm like, there are four other guys that won't allow me to let it fall apart. Like, I can't imagine being a solo artist and paying all of your friends, if you will, and the people on the road are on salary. But the five of us are like, you know, it's not that things don't go wrong, but if they do go wrong, it doesn't take very long to try to address it, if you will. And I wouldn't have it any other way. And so, you know, I do, of the five of us, I would say I hate touring the most at this point. Hate's a harsh word. I still love doing it. I love being on stage. I love doing what we're called to do. The days, we're playing basketball arenas. It's got to be the same. The towns look the same. The arenas look the same. And we just stay in our, like, we get so tired of getting off the bus to go to the hotel. We just live on the bus at the arena all day. So, you know, we started bringing motorcycles a few years ago just to get away from the venue, because it was just, you know, we're going crazy. And so saying goodbye is the hardest thing to my family. Coming home is the best thing, you know, to be with my family. The good news for us doing it this long is that, you know, with basketball, you're either in or you're out. With us, I don't know if we'll ever retire or call it quits. We'll just do less shows. Like we do about 50 shows a year now versus almost 300 for a long time. And people are like, man, 50 is still a lot. It's like, no, there's 52 weekends in a year. If I told you my job was to work only 2 days on the weekends for the whole year, that's a pretty sweet job. And that's not even 50 still. And so, it's challenging. I will say that, you know, we stayed healthy in the pandemic, and the pandemic was it was unbelievable for our family because I'd never, you know, it's one thing to be on vacation, but for the whole world to press pause to realize that I'm going to be off for a year and no one's gotten ahead of anyone else. There's not like I'm, you know, if that makes sense, it's like you come home from vacation, you're playing catch up. We were all in the same boat. And so like there were days where the most important thing that I ever had to deal with was what kind of ice cream me and my 11-year-old Sophie were going to have that day. And I hope it never happens again, but just to have the awareness to realize I'm never gonna have my kids this age. I'm never gonna have this season again. And as long as we stay healthy, it's like, and I can't go anywhere literally. And it was an amazing time. Like it, you know, I'll never forget one day at church after the pandemic, the pastor got up and said, you know, when you think of the pandemic, you know, like say it out loud, like in a couple of words, what comes to mind? And one guy was like, you know, just trying to survive or whatever. And then one guy yelled, "Save my marriage." And I was like, man, like, I mean, my marriage wasn't in dire needs, but it did wonders for our, as a parent and as a husband during that time. And it made me, I remember having a meeting right in the middle of it when we didn't work for 17 months. And I didn't know if we'd work again, didn't know what it looked like. And I remember having a meeting with the band right in the middle of it going, "Hey, I think I'm ready to be done." And they're like, no, wait, not now. We're just trying to, and I was like, well, I just want to go back to 40 or 50 shows. Like we were probably doing 80 or 90 at the time. And they all kind of stopped and realized, well, I said, let's survive. Let's get back to where we can, you know, because we were just draining our account and just trying to stay. We kept all of our crew and everybody on salary the whole time. And let's just get back to where we're comfortable. Now I'd like to just slow it all down and realize they were all feeling the same way. And so I have a bittersweet relationship with touring. I enjoy the shows. I really do. I still do. But I've never enjoyed or wanted to be home more than now, you know? And yeah, so it's, and just blessed to have the opportunity to even let that be a consideration that we can slow things down and not, you know, have to get 7 jobs or whatever. It's yeah, this is as close as musicians get to retiring, I think.
No, it's, you know, it's, I'm sure, and we've talked about it, Aaron and I have on this show, and that's, you kind of have that built-in accountability with your friends and your band guys, and that is so awesome to have because you can't survive without that. I mean, right. From, you know, my perspective as a professional athlete, I kind of had to create that, you know, wherever, you know, I was at to, you know, have that core kind of group of people that were going to, you know, help keep us all on track. And, you know, as you're going through all the craziness of travel and seeing different cities. And like you mentioned, people used to say, well, you know, what's Chicago like? What's LA like? And I'm like, well, got a pretty nice hotel and the gym's pretty cool. That's right. I don't get to see much else. And so, you know, there's that bright lights. Everybody thinks, oh man, that would be cool to travel to, you know, all over the place. It's really not that cool. I mean, yeah, it's just yeah. Like, you know, I mean, that you do get to see some neat things and have some great experiences. But yeah, it was always a challenge, particularly when you have family and, you know, it's making that work and coming in and out and leaving and coming back and all those different things that are always challenged. But, you know, staying in the word, you know, like you said, having people around you that are going to hold you accountable and to realize that, hey, man, the reason I'm doing this right now is God's allowed this to happen. I need to honor and glorify him in all that I do. And that's the goal and the challenge. But I know, man, I know we've kept you a good bit here and we need to close this thing up. But, you know, in closing, you know, from the faith aspect of our lives, you know, if there's one thing that kind of jumps out at you right now, what that God's kind of teaching you that you can encourage others with, what would that be?
Man, it's probably been the same thing I've said for quite a while that the thing that we try to say on a nightly basis is, you know, I think it now more than ever, it's so important to be reminded that there's nothing we can say or do to make Jesus love us any more than he already does right now. You know, and maybe it's me personally, I beat myself up and wish I could be better or should be better or whatever. And, And, you know, I think people need to be reminded of, hey, on your best possible day, he's not going to love you anymore. But more importantly, on your worst possible day, he's not going to love you anymore. And I think we forget about that. It's things become so performance-based and so, you know, and it, yeah. And it's just, that's, I think since 2015, that's what we've kind of decided, that we're going to try to show people what grace and identity is, and try to remind people who they are in Christ, and how we need to stop trying to clean up before we get in the shower, if you will. And just allow ourselves to be loved by the greatest thing ever. And, it sounds simple. It sounds like a Sunday school answer, but maybe they were onto something, because, it's, you know, after I just turned 50, and it still feels like the most important thing we could tell people.
No doubt. And, you know, we just appreciate your heart. So thankful that you came on a podcast today. You know, it's been fun for me, because basketball obviously was my first love, but music's always been my second love. You know, I grew up playing gospel music with my family, and
it's awesome.
And, you know, I mean, my first, you know, I really got into contemporary Christian music when it first got started. You know, we can have another episode another day, all the different groups from Sweet Comfort Band to the Imperial. Right,
heck yeah.
All the way down. And oh, by the way, I meant to say too, my first cousin is Denise Jones, who's part of Point of Grace.
No way. Oh, so, I knew this. This is the Oklahoma connection. I knew this.
Yeah. So I love music, and you guys minister to me. It's been a big part of, you know, my life, my whole time. So having you on today has been a really, really treat for me. And I will give you one Larry Bird story, since he was your favorite. You know, there's always the rumors, but this is my first time to ever get invited to the 3-point shootout contest at the All-Star game. And Larry Bird was part of that group. And so they put you all in a locker room together. You're sitting there kind of waiting to get called out on the court and go do our thing. And it's getting closer and closer to the time, and everybody's there, but Larry's not in the room. And about 5 minutes before we go to walk out on the floor, the door opens up and Larry sticks his head in the door. And he says, "Oh, sorry about that, fellas. This must be the room for second place."
Oh, my.
So,
that's amazing.
Yeah. So that's Larry Bird's story for the day. But
that's
anyway.
That's all. Yeah, we can have an episode about just, I have so many dream team questions. I'll corner you at some point. And
there we go.
I watched that documentary and was just blown away. I love the fact that, was it you the one that said you could go anywhere you wanted to? And no,
that was Stock. That was
Stock. That's right. Yeah. I remember. Yeah. I was wondering if that was like, the dynamics of that. We can talk about that later.
Well, another episode, man. Another episode.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
For sure.
We'll do the Point of Grace episode, the dream team episode.
There you go.
I'll get those scheduled. And then I got to tell you guys, as a fan of basketball and music as well, thank you both for your ministry, for your testimony, and for guys like me that need role models and people to look up to and people to help strengthen our faith. Bart, thank you for the music. Mark, thank you for your testimony. So this is a dream for me to just sit here and just be a fly on the wall with this conversation. It was amazing.
That's awesome. Thanks for having me, guys. I appreciate it.
Well, for Bart, for Mark, this has been episode 12 of the Mark Price for 3 podcast, and we will talk to you all soon.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Mark Price for 3 podcast. Remember to subscribe, like, review, and share. I'm Josh Price, and we will talk to you again on the next episode.
You don't have to go very far looking for bad news, because somehow it just finds you. So finding peace in the chaos can be really difficult, but it doesn't have to be because the River mobile app exists. The River is a Christian music radio station dedicated to playing music to help you get through life's toughest moments or life's happiest moments and everywhere in between, and all from artists who love Jesus and are real people just like you. Listening is easy. You can download it wherever you get apps from. Just search 1049 The River or listen online at riverradio.com.